The Reproduction of Daily Life, by Freddie Perlman. Part 4, Transformation of Living Activity into Capital. The transformation of living activity into capital takes place through things, daily, but is not carried out by things. Things which are products of human activity seem to be active agents because activities and contacts are established for and through things, and because people's activities are not transparent to them, they confuse the mediating object with the cause. In the capitalist process of production, the worker embodies or materializes his alienated living energy in an inert object by using instruments which are embodiments of other people's activity. Sophisticated industrial instruments embody the intellectual and manual activity of countless generations of inventors, improvers and producers from all corners of the globe and from varied forms of society. The instruments in themselves are inert objects. They are material embodiments of living activity, but are not themselves alive. The only active agent in the production process is the living laborer. He uses the products of other people's labor and infuses them with life, so to speak, but the life is his own. He is not able to resurrect the individuals who stored their living activity in his instrument. The instrument may enable him to do more during a given time period, and in this sense it may raise his productivity. But only the living labor which is able to produce can be productive. For example, when an industrial worker runs an electric lathe, he uses products of the labor of generations of physicists, inventors, electrical engineers, lathe makers. He is obviously more productive than a craftsman who carves the same object by hand. But it is in no sense the capital at the disposal of the industrial worker which is more productive than the capital of the craftsman. If generations of intellectual and manual activity had not been embodied in the electric lathe, if the industrial worker had to invent the lathe, electricity, and the electric lathe, then it would take him numerous lifetimes to turn a single object on an electric lathe, and no amount of capital could raise his productivity above that of the craftsman who carves the object by hand. The notion of the productivity of capital, and particularly the detailed measurement of that productivity, are inventions of the science of economics, that religion of capitalist daily life which uses up people's energy in the worship, admiration and flattery of the central fetish of capitalist society. Medieval colleagues of these scientists performed detailed measurements of the height and width of angels in heaven, without ever asking what angels or heaven were, and taking for granted the existence of both. The result of the worker's sold activity is a product which does not belong to him. This product is an embodiment of his labor, a materialization of a part of his life, a receptacle which contains his living activity, but it is not his, it is as alien to him as his labor. He did not decide to make it, and when it is made he does not dispose of it. If he wants it, he has to buy it. What he has made is not simply a product with certain useful properties. For that he did not need to sell his labor to a capitalist in exchange for a wage. He need only have picked the necessary materials and the available tools. He need only have shaped the materials guided by his goals and limited by his knowledge and ability. It is obvious that an individual can only do this marginally. Men's appropriation and use of the materials and tools available to them can only take place after the overthrow of the capitalist form of activity. What the worker produces under capitalist conditions is a product with a very specific property, the property of sellability. What his alienated activity produces is a commodity. Because capitalist production is commodity production, the statement that the goal of the process is the satisfaction of human needs is false. It is a rationalization and an apology. The satisfaction of human needs is not the goal of the capitalist or of the worker engaged in production, nor is it a result of the process. The worker sells his labor in order to get a wage. The specific content of the labor is indifferent to him. He does not alienate his labor to a capitalist who does not give him a wage in exchange for it, no matter how many human needs this capitalist's products may satisfy. The capitalist buys labor and engages it in production in order to emerge with commodities which can be sold. He is indifferent to the specific properties of the product, just as he is indifferent to people's needs. All that interests him about the product is how much it will sell for, and all that interests him about people's needs is how much they need to buy and how they can be coerced, through propaganda and psychological conditioning, to need more. The capitalist's goal is to satisfy his need to reproduce and enlarge capital, and the result of the process is the expanded reproduction of wage labor and capital which are not human needs. The commodity produced by the worker is exchanged by the capitalist for a specific quantity of money. The commodity is a value which is exchanged for an equivalent value. In other words, the living and past labor materialized in the product can exist in two distinct yet equivalent forms, in commodities and in money, or in what is common to both, value. This does not mean that value is labor. Value is the social form of rarefied materialized labor in capitalist society. Under capitalism, social relations are not established directly, they are established through value. Everyday activity is not exchanged directly, it is exchanged in the form of value. Consequently, what happens to living activity under capitalism cannot be traced by observing the activity itself, but only by following the metamorphoses of value. When the living activity of people takes the form of labor-alienated activity, it acquires the property of exchangeability, it acquires the form of value. In other words, the labor can be exchanged for an equivalent quantity of money wages. The deliberate alienation of living activity, which is perceived as necessary for survival by the members of capitalist society, itself reproduces the capitalist form within which alienation is necessary for survival. Because of the fact that living activity has the form of value, the products of that activity must also have the form of value, they must be exchangeable for money. This is obvious since, if the products of labor did not take the form of value, but for example the form of useful objects at the disposal of society, then they would either remain in the factory or they would be taken freely by the members of society whenever a need for them arose. In either case, the money wages received by the workers would have no value, and living activity could not be sold for an equivalent quantity of money. Living activity could not be alienated. Consequently, as soon as living activity takes the form of value, the products of that activity take the form of value, and the reproduction of everyday life takes place through changes or metamorphoses of value. The capitalist sells the products of labor on a market. He exchanges them for an equivalent sum of money. He realizes a determined value. The specific magnitude of this value on a particular market is the price of the commodities. For the academic economist, price is St. Peter's key to the gates of heaven. Like capital itself, price moves within a wonderful world which consists entirely of objects. The objects have human relations with each other, and are alive. They transform each other, communicate with each other, they marry and have children. And of course it is only through the grace of these intelligent, powerful and creative objects that people can be so happy in capitalist society. In the economist's pictorial representations of the workings of heaven, the angels do everything and men do nothing at all. Men simply enjoy what these superior beings do for them. Not only does capital produce and money work, other mysterious beings have similar virtues. Thus supply, a quantity of things which are sold, and demand, a quantity of things which are bought, together determine price, a quantity of money. When supply and demand marry on a particular point of the diagram, they give birth to equilibrium price, which corresponds to a universal state of bliss. The activities of everyday life are played out by things, and people are reduced to things factors of production, during their productive hours, and to passive spectators of things during their leisure time. The virtue of the economic scientist consists of his ability to attribute the outcome of people's everyday activities to things, and of his inability to see the living activity of people underneath the antics of the things. For the economist, the things through which the activity of people is regulated under capitalism are themselves the mothers and sons, the causes and consequences of their own activity.